Good evening. Welcome to Friday Night Service, a seminar, Deliverance Center, Phoenix, Arizona. Welcome, YouTubers. Love having you here. And I got a good one for you tonight. I haven't taught this lesson in about 3 years, so I figured it was time to get it in before 2022 ended. Part two of tonight's teaching is next month's seminar. Tonight is part one, using your discernment for divine healing. Tonight, okay. Next seminar is on December 16th, a week early. Here's all of my teachings on YouTube. As you know, you go to youtube.com/houseofhealingaz, and then you can go down to the channel section and catch the rest of the teachings, TV programs, radio shows, different things, thither and hither. Here's my radio programs. I've been on the radio for 20 years here in Maricopa County. I got them all archived. On some of them, Pandora, Omni.fm has all of them. If you'd like to help out the ministry and you happen to shop at Amazon, I heard they were laying off like 10,000 employees or something. Is that right? Why would they be doing that during Christmas? That's a good question. Somebody ought to investigate that. If you happen to shop at Amazon and if you don't know how to do that, please contact my wife. She's developed enormous expertise at shopping at Amazon. You just put in Smile Amazon, you put in our charity name, there it is. The Latter-day Saint, no, that's a different one. Hardcore Christianity, and then they will pay us when you buy something. We bought the Healing House next door. It's completely paid off, just off my wife's Amazon purchases. If you know somebody who needs to be delivered and they can't come here, I'll send them the miracle list. And it's in five languages. This gentleman learned all those languages. If you have any questions about them, check with him after the service. Send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. I'll send you out the miracle list right away. It works 100% of the time, if you do it. There's my deliverance training course, 18 classes in deliverance. You can get that in the bookstore. You can also find out about the seven churches of Revelation, how they relate to 2023 in the bookstore. Thursday nights is our main service of the week. Brother Rick and the ministry team are here for healing and deliverance. Fantastic. You can download our app and donate to us on your phone if you want to. We have donation boxes on the doors. As you leave, there's a video camera in each one of them. If you pass the box without making a donation, you will be outed on the internet. Stop that. You can donate on the website if you go there and hit the PayPal button. Thank you. Tomorrow is my monthly deliverance training class. It's my favorite service of the month because I get a lot of questions and answers. So we have time to dig into some issues that I wouldn't have time to do now. I'll see you at noon over there tomorrow. December 10th is our next children's It's the Bomb deliverance service. Erica's taken this thing in a direction I wouldn't even have thought to do. It's fantastic. And the people that show up from the ministry team, they're doing a killer job. 10 o'clock in the morning, bring your son or daughter or your grandchild, preteens, and watch them get healed. All right, we have a Miracle List support group. Julie is running that, and it's going fantastic. That's also in the small sanctuary every other Tuesday starting in January. There's all my radio programs every week. I'm on 7 days a week on the radio, 1010 AM Christian Radio. Please remember to set up an ambush team in your church where you have two or three people in a secret group, and you start picking off the sick people in your church. Here's how you do it. You just approach them and say, "Hi, I noticed I heard your prayer request the other day. Would you mind if we met with you and prayed with you?" And, you know, keep it low key like that. Do not rush up to a parishioner and say, "Hey, Saturday morning, you better be there. You're loaded with demons." Okay. Do not that approach. It works on YouTube for clicks and like, but in reality, that approach is not going to work. Don't start yelling at someone. They've got demons. That's going to cause some problems. Just, you know, be loving and gentle about it. "Hey, we'd like to pray with you." Work out the schedule, you know. And then as you get one healed, then that one tells this one, then the next one comes, and pretty soon you got too many to handle. Yeah. And then pretty soon you get kicked out. There's the big three. Those are my books I wrote on Satan, mental illness, and healing in the bookstore. Every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, I have a podcast. If you don't go to church and you happen to be home, twitch.tv. Or you can go to my Facebook page, Michael W. Smith. See you Sunday morning. Here's our services have expanded around here. We've got basically two Zoom deliverance services every week, Tuesdays and Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. If you send me an email, I'll send you the ID and the passcode. I also am doing Zoom group meetings now. I've done one a week so far. If you have a home group or something and you want to get together on Zoom, chit chat, answering questions, different things, be happy to do that. We'll set it up. Okay? Send me an email and we'll get that done quickly. I'll see you for Christmas in Carlsbad. Christmas in Carlsbad, Christmas Eve. We're going to have a service there. And we're going to take each and every person that comes one at a time and blow them out. This is my new Zoom broadcast. Wait a minute here. That's a duplicate. Strike that. Our Thursday and Friday nights broadcasts, this one right now, is being shown on these platforms. We expanded because we had been getting some guff from YouTube. And we had gotten in trouble over a virus issue. So we expanded our platforms in case we get canceled. And that's what we expanded them to. So far, YouTube has not sent us any more notices, because we've been minding. Now, that's a term that we used when I was a kid back in the 50s. You need to learn to mind. And that meant? Yes. And I'm generally speaking, it's a challenge for me to mind. I'm not built that way. But when I get the anointing, I can, you know, accomplish it. The next day, our services are broadcast on these platforms. We're going to fix these codes here, making them all uniform pretty soon. I apologize for that, but we're going to switch all these. But that's how you can watch it the following day. Of course, my YouTube has it as well. All right, let's start on divine healing. Before I start the seminar, I want to make a quick announcement. I just found out about this a couple days ago. There's some people coming to the Deliverance Center asking for money. Okay, and when people come to a service and somebody asks them for money, they may never come back here. Okay, people don't feel comfortable with people asking them for money. Yeah? There's a lot of good-hearted people that come here and give people money, okay? But generally speaking, it's going to cause a problem, okay? So please do not give people money when you come to the Deliverance Center. I don't want anybody to feel uncomfortable or obligated or think that we have anything to do with it or whatever the devil comes up with. He always comes up with something to cause division. So just be aware of that. Please don't do that anymore, because I think we've lost some people that don't attend the service anymore over this 2022 because people were asking for money. I didn't know what was going on that extensively. Divine healing. Divine healing is a very controversial and very confusing issue. And before I start, I want to tell you, I do not have all the answers either. I don't understand all of it either. Some people just die. Okay? It just happened today. My neighbor. Okay? I went over to my neighbor. My wife was helping her. She's 90, 99, I believe, 98, was in great shape, up until a couple of months ago. And she started deteriorating, okay? Beautiful woman of God, loaded with faith, dying. And I went over yesterday or the day before. I had some prayer with her. I made sure she was ready to go, you know. Other people had been praying for her to be healed. And I said to her, what would you like to do? And she said, well, I would love to go home. And I said, I tell you what, that's a prayer I think God's going to answer. Let's just do that. Father, in the name of Jesus, I put my hands on her body like that. I said, Lord, thank you for your faithful servant and this wonderful neighbor we had. She's a peach. And you know what? She just needs to go home now. And her health has deteriorated dramatically. And I want to thank you for all the wonderful years she had, how faithful she's been. Thank you, Jesus. And she and I agree together in prayer that she is to go home. And tomorrow, the next day, is fine with me. How about you? That sounds good. Thank you, Jesus. All right, well, it's a done deal. Go on home. Boom. And she just died today. Okay, so what was the point of that story? I don't understand everything about God or divine healing or life and death. I don't have all the answers. Okay? The reason I can admit that is because I'm not a TV preacher trying to get you to send me your parents' inheritance. I can be truthful and honest with you and just speak as a regular person, because I myself am an ordinary man. All the healings and miracles that have ever happened here or anywhere else come by the power of the Holy Ghost. That's right. It comes by the broken body of Christ. I had zero to do with it. I did not kill my neighbor. I just simply agreed with her that, look, hey, you're so sick, it's unreal. You're 98 years old. Hello? That's a good Lord confirming what I'm saying. Hear him there. He just piped in. Thank you. Hey, I just agreed with her. Time to go home. Now she's home. See? And that woman, my neighbor, is a million times better off than any person sitting here today. And she is doing cartwheels up there. She wouldn't come back here if she was asked to come back or told to come back. She is so happy. She's sick to her stomach. She's so happy. Thrilled with glory. What's it like up there? I don't know. I've never been there. Well, I've got a friend of mine that's been there several times. Whoa! Click. Altar call. Those are familiar spirits. They have not been there several times. Stop! Stop. And if I have to, I'll come over to their house. You don't want to go? Too bad. Bye. So that's how we do it. So some people, you pray the stuffing out of them, and they die, okay? Some people you don't pray for at all, they live, okay? What's the point of saying something like that? I don't know everything. See that load I lifted off me? Oh, yeah. Oh, he's shrewd. But I know more about it than the average Christian, and that's why I'm going to share some things that God taught me and I'm going to share with you. Bingo. Let's start, shall we? It's always better to start at section one. Believing and receiving is the key. Jesus said, and this is him quoting Matthew 13, these people, their hearts are gross. What's that mean? You know, it's a copper term. They're hardened over. Ugh. They're dull of hearing. They hear naturally, but they don't hear spiritually. There's a big difference. And their eyes are closed to spiritual things. And if it wasn't that way, Jesus said, they would be able to hear me and understand what I'm saying, and they could be converted so I could heal them. Well, I don't know about you, but that sounds like Jesus wants to heal people. That's the way I kind of interpret that verse. Luke 5. His fame spread everywhere, it says, and great multitudes came to hear and to be healed by him of their infirmities. Asthenia is a Greek word. It means human weaknesses. Healing can be a tremendous gospel spreader. People hear about a healing and they go, wow, what? That's interesting. Let me investigate that. Well, that's what Jesus used in his ministry. These incredible healings were pointed toward a new goal. What was that? God's holy word and seeing people get saved. In order to understand divine healing, you have to understand Satan's power to cause sickness and illnesses and diseases. And it was revealed in Job chapter 1 and 2. If you go back and read those books, I got an email today from some self-righteous religious kook. She says to me, why did God create human beings when he knew beforehand they were going to fail? Okay? So, God doesn't work that way. Here's what he does. He sets you up in a perfect spot. Then he gives you free will. And then he takes a step back and wants to see what you're going to do with it. Adam and Eve, right? Super GQ, drop dead gorgeous, Garden of Eden, paradise, but free will. Oh no. Why does God want free will? Because he doesn't want cyborgs or robots. He wants you. He wants your personality. He wants your desire. He wants your interests. He wants your motivation. He wants to see what you individually are going to do. It's all based on human free will. The whole planet's going to hell in a handbasket because humanity chose a handbasket and hell. And God divinely gives you that choice to decide for yourself what's going to happen to you. You decide what you're going to do with your life. Period. Everything is up to you. All right. You read through the book of Job, and it is absolutely spectacular, to say the least. The science in the book of Job is incredible. But if you'll notice in the book, God revealed to us by opening this curtain behind the scenes of healing and deliverance, look, there's somebody back there doing it. And this book was spectacular in its divine revelations. The Bible says specifically, Satan murdered Job's employees. It says he murdered his livestock and his farmers. It says he caused human beings to steal his property, it says. Okay? It says that Satan killed Job's children, manipulating the weather, causing a tornado. The devil has power to control the weather. Job was made sick because of Satan. Satan gave him sicknesses. Satan sent him three fake friends. I've met some of you, and you've got considerably more than that. These people you think are your friends are actually plants that God, the devil sent to you to betray you in your time of need. They appear to be friends here, but when the going gets tough over here, they're gone. They turn on you. If you have this in your past, you are like Job. His three friends showed up and made numerous false statements and gave him untold amounts of bad advice. And number seven, the killer. Everybody in the Job's family was killed except one person. I won't talk much about that because my wife's in the office over here. Got it. But he happened to notice something here. Satan's power, when God pulled the curtain back for us, which we had never seen before, caught. You notice he has power to do all these things. Most people do not think he can do that. The Bible specifically says he can do it and has done it and is doing it. Here it goes, Job chapter 1. The Lord said to Satan, where you come from? He said, I go to and fro over the face of the earth. Wow, isn't that amazing? That's exactly what happens. Satan doesn't do it personally. He sends battalions of demons all over the planet, looking around, looking for an opening, looking for somebody to kill or make sick or steal from. And Jehovah said, have you considered my servant Job? That was mistranslated in the King James Bible. Sumleb is, I see you're considering my servant Job. So what had happened was, God noticed Satan was stalking Job. Okay? And the Bible guarantees you that the Holy Ghost knows when the demons are stalking you. He's got you covered. Your guardian angel watches you 24/7, and the Holy Spirit is never caught off guard by anything. Not in a million years. You cannot catch him off guard. He's watching the attacks coming at you long before they get to you. Before you were born, he saw the devil attacking you tomorrow before you were born. That's the kind of knowledge he has. Satan does not have knowledge remotely close to that. And it says here, you know, to put it in layman's term, God saw that Job was next. Job had a target on his back. Satan had grown weary of Job as he has grown weary of you. If you start doing the right thing, and you try to do the right thing, and you want to do the right thing, sooner or later, somebody's going to notice what you're doing. Hey, over here. Over here. This person's changing. This person cares. This person actually wants to help. And somebody's going to notice that on the dark side. Job got picked up. Somebody noticed it. The devil saw, hey, this guy, look, he even compliments Job. There it is. He's a pious man. He does what I want done. He honors me. He respects me. That caught him. Somebody noticed. When you get noticed, guess what's going to happen to you? Somebody's going to try to stop it. You think you're just going to continue to do what's right? Wow, this Christianity is a cakewalk. Sweet. Okay, that's church crap. I'm talking about reality here. You want to do the right thing? You're going to get noticed. Somebody's going to catch it. And then somebody's going to try to stop it. Can they stop it? Back to free will. There we go again. Can they stop it? Yes, depending on your free will, not depending on God. God already told you, hey, I'm going to take care of you. I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. It's not possible. But it is possible for you not to believe. Your free will determines where you end up in life, in every phase and every asset of it. It has nothing to do with God. God already said, hey, I unconditionally love you. I want to be with you in eternity. You're my guy. You're my gal. Hey, I got a storehouse of blessings waiting for you. I'd be happy to send them to you. Yeah? But you can say, you know what? I don't know. I don't really deserve anything. I'm unworthy. Okay. Then you don't get anything. Why? Because you believed a lie and that's your free will. You have a right to believe Satan. That is your God-given right. If you choose to do that, God will not stop you. He will honor you and your decision. God honors people's decisions. Well, Job had decided, hey, I'm going to serve the Lord. Uh-oh, he got caught. Oh, somebody saw him. What happened? Well, the good Lord took that opportunity to give us the book of Job so we could peek behind the curtain and see that it never was his friends. It wasn't the weather. It wasn't his wife. It was somebody behind everything that happened to him. And what God was showing us in Job was, hey, I'm giving you a divine revelation of the spirit world. That was the purpose of Job. You get a peek behind the scenes. This is what goes on. Now, this doesn't exactly go on with you. I mean, Satan's never going to come to your house and have anything to do with you, but he sent somebody there to do it. Yeah, they're following you, stalking you. They're watching everything you do. And if you start to make progress, somebody's going to notice it. Somebody's going to try to stop it. And it becomes a battle of what? Your free will. You choose to do what the Lord said. The devil cannot stop you. He doesn't have that kind of power. You decide not to go that way. He has enormous power to wipe you out. And he'll do it happily and move on to the next fool who doesn't exercise their godly free will. Here's what you got to understand about healing, though, even though we don't understand everything about it. It is not the will of your Heavenly Father that one of these little lost sheep should perish. Everybody knows the parable of the lost sheep, correct? Yeah, it's a beautiful parable. It gives you an idea of the love of God for your life. He left all these behind and went out hunting for you. You were lost and alone and helpless and defenseless. He left this group and went to get you. What a great parable that is. Beautiful. Thelema, what does that mean? The will of God. It is not the will of God that one of these should perish, right? The Lord is not slack concerning his promise. He wants what? He is long-suffering to us more that what? Not willing that any perish, No one. God wants 100% of everybody saved. I can't believe that. Yeah. You mean Jeffrey Dahmer could have got saved? Jeffrey Dahmer could have been speaking in tongues in prison. Yes, he could. He could have been running the devotionals, prophesying over the other murderers. Did he choose to do that? No, he chose to go to hell. But now, that was his choice. Father wanted Jeffrey Dahmer, even though he ate people. I've eaten some bad food in my time. Never have I taken a bite out of another person. To me, that's gross. I wasn't raised like that. Jeffrey was somehow. Guess what? He would have left the others behind to go get Jeffrey had he called. What? Believable. Every human being, no matter how demon possessed they are, has some tiny scrap of love in them. Did you know that? Huh? You know that? They do. Jeffrey, Joseph Stalin used to have meetings on how to exterminate people. And they'd have a group meeting. Now, how many people can we kill and how fast can we kill them? If his daughter called in the middle of a mass murder meeting, he would stop what he was doing and go see what she wanted. He'd find out what she wanted, give her what she needed, and then he'd go back to the mass murdering meeting and say, now how many people can we starve out this year? Did you know that? There was some love in there for his daughter, right? Yeah, what happened to him? Oh, he's burning in hell now. But I'm just saying, as a human being, almost every single person has at least a scrap in there. Adolf Hitler was very much in love with his German shepherd. He had a beautiful German shepherd. And he came home from a busy day slaughtering people. First thing he'd go to was that dog. The dog would run up to him like he was a Christmas fairy. Adolf, you're beautiful. They'd scrub each other's ears. He'd go back and get him some dinner, then go back to planning on how to mass murder a bunch of Jews. There was some kind of love in Hitler for that dog, okay? The guy was totally demon-possessed. Huh? Those two people could have been scooped. Oh, that's infamous blasphemy. No, it isn't. He would have left this group and gone after Stalin had he fallen on his knees and confessed and repented. He could have been not willing that any should perish. Any includes mass murderers, correct? It even includes politicians. Can't believe he said that. Stupid. 1 Timothy chapter 2, here it is. God does not, Phalo, want. God wants all men to be sozo, delivered, and come to the knowledge of the truth. To understand the Holy Ghost, you got to understand that he's given us a green light. He wants to help us. He wants to heal you. He wants to save you. Whosoever will may come and drink of the waters of life freely. Revelations. It says, whosoever Phalo wants to. Hebrews 2, through death, Jesus might destroy him that had the Kratos. What is that? Satan runs the death business. That's his job. He just killed my neighbor. How'd he do it? Sicknesses, old age. He killed her. I just asked for an acceleration of it by God, because it was time for her to go home. She wanted to go home. Good woman of God. She was happy to go home. She told me she wanted to go home. I didn't go over there and have her. Mike, don't pray that way. I want to live. Hey, I would have watched it. That's cool. I'm good. Love you. I'm good with it. You know, I just wanted to know what made her comfortable. But that was the devil doing that. See, he makes you old, then he makes you sick, and then he kills you. That's what he does. Period. Who's destroying the works of the devil? Well, my goodness, I think I stumbled on it. You've got the green light by God. You got a green light. And what does he want to do? He wants to deliver you. He wants to deliver everyone who is afraid of death. She wasn't afraid of death, my neighbor. She knew where she was going. She was a born-again Christian. She wasn't feeling death. She was welcoming it. I said to her, "You've been sick for a little while?" She said, "Yeah, I've been sick, and I feel like I'm going to die." And I said, "You do?" She said, "Yeah, I just didn't know it would take this long." She wanted to go home. So I just chipped in. But it was the devil who killed her. It was Father that saved her. She just took off today. And what she's doing now, I don't know. But I'll tell you what, it's better than what I'm doing right now. And I'm good with what I'm doing right now. She is ecstatic, to say the least. I'll be following her shortly. I'm an old person myself. And I'm going to do what she did. Is this taking too long? Slavery. Dulia, you are a slave to death. Everybody's a slave to death. And that's the last enemy that will be destroyed. The Bible says is death. For this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might build mega churches and win people to Christ through a sinner's prayer. No, it says destroy the works of the devil. That is the purpose of the living Christ, is to luo, untie you from your bondage, unchain you from your prison. That's the purpose of him. His purpose is to give you eternal life and save you from damnation, judgment, and hell. Sickness, the work of the devil, is the purpose of the living Christ. You're supposed to be healed. Anything that's the work of the devil is to be luo, loosed from you. What are the works of the devil? Hey, we could sit here all night. Jesus had a great commission. He gave us one in Matthew 28, Mark 16, and Luke 24. But Father gave him a great commission. What was it? It's right here. In Isaiah 61, Luke repeated it. He has called me to and anointed me to preach good news. Deliverance and healing and salvation and eternal life. And my neighbor's death today was all good news. Her dying was good news and a relief to my ears. When I heard that, I started to praise. Well, that sounds crazy. It isn't crazy. Death can be the ultimate victory. It's good news. That's what the gospel is, Evangelion. It means glorious good news. Because he sent me to heal the brokenhearted. Now, do you happen to notice that people's broken hearts was put ahead of their physical healing in this list. Anybody happen to notice that? People who are crushed in here, shattered in here. I've been a counselor for 40 years. I spent 40 years working with people with these problems. 40 years I've been doing it. That's a hike. And to do what? What was Jesus sent by Father to do? Ephesus, to proclaim freedom to people who are in bondage, people that are captives. This is a great Bible study. Wow! That's the purpose of it. Well, this doesn't sound like my church. It isn't your church. The churches are jacked up. Okay, they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. Freedom from people who are in bondage is the purpose of the Son of God's life on earth. He wants to recover your sight and to set you at liberty. Same Greek word, Ephesus. Freedom to people who are crushed. And to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. My neighbor, when I visited her yesterday, she was crushed. Her body had shrunk to nothing. She had scrapes on her face, bruises on her face from falling. She couldn't get out of bed anymore. She said, I didn't know it would take this long. I said, well, let's fix that. Yeah. If you know somebody that's in that condition, here's the way I handle it. I find out what they want done. And if they want to go home, then I just agree with them in prayer. It's time for you to go home. And usually the Lord takes them. Yeah. That's freedom. She got enormous freedom today. Freedom from chronic pain. She was having severe pain. 3 days ago, the doctors ordered her a batch of morphine. You know, that's what they do in hospice when they're in chronic pain. Give them a bunch of morphine. Yeah. You know what? We don't need to go through this anymore. Are you ready to go? Yeah, all right. Go. Scram. Yeah. Yes, sir. To preach the acceptable year of the Lord. That is today. Acts 10. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. Dunamis, supernatural power, who went about doing good and healing all who were katadunastuo, dominated over by the devil. That's demonic oppression, okay? We do deliverance around here all the time, and those are demons coming out of the person, but you cannot be delivered from these demons. They oppress you. Everybody has that. No one escapes it. Well, that's kind of a downer. No, it isn't. That's the way life is. Look, everybody faces challenges. Everybody goes through trials. Nobody is exempt. Not one person. Okay? Most of us were not raised in royalty. Thank God. Because the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, not many people in royalty are called. It's us scumbuckets that go in. Yes, sir. I am a proud member of the Society of Scumbuckets because I got chosen by God for mercy. Now stick that in your ear. Everybody gets oppressed by the oppression comes from the outside. Infection is inside, hitting you from the inside. The demons on the inside work with the ones on the outside to beat the crap out of you. It's a spiritual term. It's tag team wrestling. You choose from your own free will to use your authority you can beat them both. But you got to choose it. Healing all that were oppressed by the devil. How'd those sections go? Any problems? Anybody mad at me about anything? Have I been a little too blunt for this section? Okay, they're ready for section four. Now remember, when you go through the text and in your ministry, because many of you are going to have healing ministries after tonight, and I want you to be able to discern different types of healings, right? But you must remember that in Jesus's ministry, they always were combined. There was no Jesus deliverance ministry separate from Jesus's healing ministry. Why is that? Because many of the illnesses were caused by spirits. So they can't be separated, okay? John says to him, Lord, we saw somebody, Gabalatin, casting out devils in your name, okay? Now that Greek word there was a present active tense word. So what it means was, they saw some guy over there repetitively, continuously, routinely casting out demons. They didn't see some guy do it once and that was it. See the context there?
Yeah.
The context, and remember, you can't take the verses out of context. If you do, you become a cult. That's what cults do. They pull a verse out of context and then you come up with some crazy doctrine. Prosperity is based on context removed verses. You pull the text out and then you throw it at somebody and it sticks in their brain. Yeah? You got to look at the context of the text to be able to interpret it properly. Am I right?
Yeah.
Any Jehovah's Witnesses here? No. Okay. So the context of the text was, hey, this guy, oh man, he was blowing demons out of this group, this people, this person, that gal, this boy. That, wow, he sounds like he had a pretty powerful anointing and a continuous deliverance ministry, doesn't it? That's what it sounds like. But if you just read it here, the way the King James people translated it, it sounds like a one-off. But it wasn't. This guy was a professional. See, this guy was a real deal. Okay, and then we'll get to the next verse in that context. Then the next verse would be in that context. We told him to stop doing that, but because he wasn't following with us. Okay. They spotted some guy over there doing what they were doing. The disciples were continuously, repetitively and constantly blowing demons out of people. Jesus was doing the same thing. And then they saw another guy doing what they were, continuously doing it. Right? Okay. Next, Jesus said, don't stop him. There is no man which shall do a miracle in my name. Now here it is again. The King James verse is not helping us very much. Do actually meant what that guy was doing and what they were doing. Present active tense verb. Repetitively doing it. See? They were doing it routinely. They were doing it. He was doing it. Jesus was doing it. And Jesus said, somebody who's repetitively casting out demons in my name, Cannot what? Next verse. Kaku can flippantly, indifferently blow me off. The way that verse is written, it sounds like I could interpret it this way. That guy cast a demon out of somebody. Stop doing that. Stop it. Well, you don't know how that demon came out of there. You don't know who that guy, you don't know nothing about it. But if you saw the guy day after day, hour after hour doing that, you would then get an idea, hey, wait a minute, this guy's the real deal. It's not a one-off. It didn't just happen once. So Jesus is saying, if you see somebody healing somebody in my name all over the place, casting demons out all over the place, leading people to Christ and winning souls all over the place, if you see somebody doing that, they're not going to trash me because that person's the real deal. If it's a Peter Popoff or something and it's a con artist healing, then yeah, they might say something later about having no respect for me, blowing me off, treating me lightly. Yeah. But if you see somebody with a track record of doing that, Jesus said, don't stop him. They're the real deal. Does that help? That verse has been misinterpreted so many times over the years, you wouldn't have believed it. But they didn't take a close enough look at it to clarify it. We've been doing deliverance in this building for... Does anybody know how long we've been here? 2016. I just heard an anointed voice from somewhere. What was that? What was that voice?
I think she said 2017
we moved here? Okay. Look, we've been doing the same thing for 2017 to 2022, thereabouts, right? So that would be
five years.
Yeah. So there's some prima facie evidence, to quote the lawyers, that we are a legitimate outfit. Okay. This isn't a one-off. I wasn't born last night. Now, no matter how long you've been doing any ministry, the person doing it obviously has flaws. Okay? And some of you are going to faint here. I have flaws.
Say what?
But I have been informed numerous times, my wife doesn't have any. Has no flaws. No flaws. My wife, she's the wrong one. What's God telling you? You never believe somebody until you have time to see their spiritual fruit. This is how people get sucked in to these imbeciles on TV. These people are charlatans, they're crooks, they're thieves, and they have personality, they have charisma, and they've got music. Jesus is telling you, hey, back off from that and watch over a period of time before you make a determination on whether somebody's valid or not. It takes time and interest to see someone's spiritual fruit. That's what that verse was saying. Hey, don't shut him down. He's got a track record of Holy Ghost spiritual fruit. Right? We saw someone repetitively casting out demons in your name, and we told him to stop it because he wasn't in our church, in our group, in our denomination. And Jesus says, cut the spiritual fruits there. They don't have to be in our group, our denomination, our church. The Holy Ghost is the church. Come on now. Uh-oh. YouTube just called. They brought to him all sick people, taken with all kinds of things, and the verse goes on to describe it. And it covers everything in this section of text here. It's Matthew chapter 4, right? It goes on to this verse here. Here's the verse. There's all the diseases. I should have put that slide the other direction. But anyway, apologize. This is what he was talking about. A lunatic, seleniazomai, was a person who was severely mentally ill. And it means moonstruck. And what happened was, it still happens today. As soon as there's a full moon, the demons attack people in mental institutions, severely mentally ill people. They ramp it up. And the reason they were doing that is because they wanted them to think it had something to do with the moon and the tides. See? So the demons would hide behind a full moon. See? And there's a bunch of demonic stuff out there about blood moons and all this. Everything's moon now. Everything's, trust me, mooning, moons are not, drop it. Okay. This is also the moon. Drop that one, okay? Put all the moon doctrine in the same pair of pants and drop it. Drop it. You're going to get deceived. There's no blood moons or blue moons. Stop all that. Quit. Quit. Back in the day, demons would flare up when there was a full moon. So they called them moonstruck or seleniazomai. That's how it worked. And by the way, that still happens today. The state hospital down here on Van Buren, they still have patients who manifest during full moons. Okay? It's all demonic. They're just hiding. They'll hide anywhere. Okay? And you know what the rest of these are? And he healed all of them, right? Paraluticus, that's a paralyzed for a spinal cord injury. Daimonizomai, somebody who's demonized. We see that here, obviously, all the time. People are being tormented by demons. See that here all the time. Basinus is to be tortured. Okay? And it says he healed them all. Why is he healing them all? Because God's a good God. John said God is love. He doesn't just love you. That's not good enough. That's all he knows how to do. Because that's what he is. Any person loaded with rejection demons always tells you, I'm unworthy and God's not listening to my prayers. That is a fabricated out and out lie. There isn't anything God can do but love you. Even when you're failing, even when you're screwing up, even when you're sinning, it doesn't matter. You are unconditionally loved. So when you fail, bang, get up and go. Failed again, good. Get up and go. Screwed up again, did you? Great. Go. Why? Because love has got it covered. All of them were healed that wanted healed. Now remember, not we're all healed? Of course not. Free will kept some people away. They didn't want to get near him. They didn't believe in it. Okay, gotcha. I'm with you. They didn't get healed. Fine. Everybody that wanted to get healed got healed. There's no exception. Everyone is loved. There's no exception. None. Everyone is unconditionally loved by God. And here's the verse that had those in there. I had it out of order. I apologize for that. He cast out the demons with his word. Okay, why is that put in there? Why did they put that in? Well, Matthew's got a Jewish flair to it. And the only deliverance the Jews had was Solomon had a book on it. The Talmud had some writings on it. And they were all involving ceremonial deliverances, like religion. Religion is all full of ceremonials. See, it's all a bunch of crap. So he comes along and casts them out with his word. And Matthew noted that in the text because it was significant for Jews. See, it should be significant for Catholics because Catholics picked up where the Jews left off. Now they go through all kinds of ceremonial deliverances. Pour, punch, cross. They pull out a big old cross, 4 feet wide. You devil, I'm not coming out. Oh, yes, you are. No, I kind of scared you, didn't I? I made that up. That's not me. He put it in there because it's important. He was only using his word to command the spirits to come out, so that they would know this wasn't a bunch of Solomon stuff. This isn't a bunch of Pharisee stuff. See the difference? This is a Holy Ghost stuff. Bang! Take that. Healing all that were sick. Why? God wants to heal you. He likes you. He wants to help you. God's a good God. God is love. And then Matthew proves it by quoting the Old Testament scripture about Jesus. He took our weaknesses, asthenia, he took our nosos, diseases, he took them to Calvary. How'd that section go? You got to understand to be in the healing ministry that God wants to heal. Does he heal 100%? No. Why not? I don't have all the answers. But I do know God wants to heal everyone. If something's blocking it for some reason or another, okay, I got you. But that doesn't mean God doesn't want to save you and heal you. He wants to deliver you. He wants to help you. Thelo, I want to. That same Greek word was used with the dying leper, wasn't it? Matthew chapter 8. Lord, if you want to, Thelo, you could make me clean. I want to. I want to. That settled it. That's it for me. Every person that comes into my office, no matter how jacked up they are, and I've seen some super jacked up people. I may lead the country in it. I see more jacked up people. But every single one of them, God wanted to heal. So I developed that mindset, no matter who comes in, no matter how severe this and that is, I say to myself, he wants to help this person. Okay. Now, they may not like me, which proves they're nuts, or they may not want to get healed. Now that's out of my control, but in my mindset stays the same. He wants to help you. That's his desire, is to help this person and that one and this one, and 100% of every person I see for 40 years, he wanted to help them, period. You got to get it settled in your mind if you want to go into the healing business, right? You can't develop an attitude of, well, you know, have you prayed for him? Yeah, we did. We prayed. Well, I don't know. God, he doesn't want to heal everybody. What do you see? What you're saying? When you say that to one person, you have blown the gospel out the back door. If you said God doesn't want to heal someone, how are you going to explain that? Well, you've got to contradict every one of these verses I just shared with you. You have to contradict everyone. You've got to come up with a theory or a theology to contradict every one of them. What is it? I want to hear it. God doesn't want to heal somebody. Is that what you've heard? I've heard it. What's your reasoning? How come nobody said anything? Well, Well, listen, you can say something and I won't embarrass you that much. All right. Section 5, then, you asked for it. When you are in the healing business, so to speak, you got to be able to discern what Jesus did. Is a healing related to a spirit or is it a medical condition? There's a difference between a spiritual illness and a medical illness. If I drive home drunk, hit a tree, hurt myself, the trauma is medical. I got in a car accident. If I trip at work and I hit my head on the desk, that's a trauma event. That's a medical condition. I have contusion, brain damage, whatever the diagnosis is, depending on severity. Correct? So in that kind of a person, you would want to focus on healing more than deliverance, because you drove into the tree, the demons didn't grab the wheel, hit the accelerator, and that didn't happen. You did it. Okay? You drove home drunk. Stop doing that. Now here's an example, quickly. The Syrian woman, she hunts down Jesus, she stalks him. And there's one thing that God loves, and that's a stalker. I'll tell you what. Oh man, I'll tell you, that makes him happy. He loves somebody to stalk him. Oh man, he loves it. It makes him happy. He is thrilled. Blind Bartimaeus was stalking him. He couldn't see him, but he knew he was out there somewhere. Hey, Son of God, have mercy on me. He stops, the Bible says, and turns around. Who's yelling at me? There was people lying in that street, 10 deep. He never stopped for one of them. Somebody was stalking him. You can go into a church and see thousands of people, nobody getting a blessing of any kind. One person gets a miracle from God because there was a stalker in the group. That's right. 10 deep. One woman bleeding. Cervix cancer. You know what? Somebody touched me. What are you, nuts? There's 50,000 people here. There's only 5,000 people live in this town. You think somebody touched you? Yeah, I had a stalker. It was her. Be of good cheer, woman. Your faith has made you whole. This is good preaching. I'm going to start preaching from now. I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm going to start preaching. God loves a stalker, friend. Don't you ever forget it. Somebody that stalks him, pushes in, presses in, they get miracles. This woman is a nasty stalker. She was the worst stalker in the Bible. You know that? She sure was. Kragazo. She was yelling on top of yelling. She was screaming at him, "Hey! Yeshua!" She was yelling so loud. The disciples came to Jesus. "Hey, we got a stalker. Can you get rid of this crazy woman? She's not even Jewish. Get rid of her." And Jesus said, "Well, okay, calm down. Chill yourself out, John. What do you want?" "My daughter. I'm interceding for my daughter." See, what people don't understand, particularly in the Department of Education, is once you get a mother of a child pissed off, you're in trouble. They overplayed their hand on that woke stuff because they had a bunch of mothers get upset. They weren't worried about the dads. They don't show up. The mother shows up. Hell came to breakfast at the Department of Education. She was interceding for her daughter. Mothers who are desperate for their children to be healed, don't take no for an answer. The disciples said, hey, get out of here. What are you doing? You're not Jewish. Go back to Syria, you dog. She won't leave. She wasn't leaving. Why? She was a stalker. She stalked. Oh, man. I've been praying for 17 years to have a room full someday of stalkers. It hadn't happened yet, but I'm still believing for it. I want every seat filled with a stalker. Because I'm going to get every seat healed, every seat delivered. Without a failure. Hey, listen, this is the children's bread deliverance. We don't pitch it out to the puppies. We don't do that. What a Lord, hold on a minute. Think about it for a second. Even the puppies coming around and they get these crumbs from the woman. Great is your faith. . 100% of all stalkers get miracles from God. 100%. Jesus said not a word. His disciples said to him, hey, get rid of this dog. She's yelling at us. Wow. Religious people don't like to be yelled at. Oh, man, I'll turn on you like that. You yell at somebody who's a religious person, oh, you're dead in the water. It's over for you, pal. So they tattled on her. They said, hey, Lord, this dog from Syria is yelling at us. We heard him yelling. Well, Jesus wasn't deaf. He was setting this story up for the Holy Ghost to put in the Bible for us. That's why that story's in there. And he's just watching to see their reaction, the church people, see? See, when you become a stalker, the church people disappear like cockroaches when you flip a light on. Where'd they go? My God. The church people disappear. Why? Somebody was desperate for God, came to the service. That makes us feel uncomfortable. I don't feel comfortable about somebody yelling for God. Yeah, that's because you're a gutless spiritual loser. People that are desperate for miracles always get them. Send her away. She's yelling at us. Nobody yells at us. We're on the board. Hey, I came to the lost sheep of Haas. What was he doing there? Running her down? No, he was setting this story up to tell you that, hey, perseverance gets miracles from God. If you can be talked out of your miracle in 50 seconds, you didn't really want it. So he puts another little roadblock in her way just to watch her, see what she'll do. Oh, wait a minute. No, no, no. No. Glory to your name. Whoa. Now we've got bad problems. We've got a Gentile worshiping the Moshiach, the Messiah. And the disciples, the church people are standing around. Filling their depends. See, God doesn't care whether you're Jew or Gentile. He's looking for stalkers. We don't just throw the children's bread to the puppies. Gunarian, they're puppies. That's what Gentiles were to Jews. Jews were the big dogs. Gentiles were the puppies. We don't throw deliverance to the puppies. What was he doing there? Helping us to see, hey, a little more perseverance. Just take another step forward. Just work your way around that problem. Beat that issue. Just come in a little closer. He wasn't trying to run her off. He was helping us with this incredible story. And she nails it. Remember, she had already worshiped him and then said he was the master of the table. Oh, that got him. That gets him. You want to get the Lord? Oh, you can. You'll nail him to the wall. Bang! Come in with some praise. Oh, that. He stops. Who's yelling at me? Oh, that's blind Bartimaeus. He's our neighborhood moron. Oh, really? No, you guys are the morons. Bring him here. Then after they said, come here, suddenly the people all around him became his friends. Like Job's friends. My goodness. Oh, be of good cheer. He's calling for you. And put in a word for me, will you? You see, once God moves on a stalker, the Mickey Mouse church people who scattered like roaches start coming out from under the cabinets. Hey, somebody's got the anointing. Well, maybe I can get in on something. Now, you're not going to get in on anything because you're not a stalker. You're a watcher. I'm going to watch and see what happens. Then I'm going to feel it right. Stupid. You just watch what they do. Then you emulate it and you win. What do you think these stories are in here for? This is God showing you, this is my road map to miracles. Just get over that little hump. Get past that one. Push your way in. Bang! It falls. Woman! Go home! Daughter's delivered. And there's her daughters. Her whole family got together after the deliverance. They were so happy. You see, God wants to heal you. He wants to deliver you. He wants you to be happy. He wants to see you happy. Is anybody following this? Is the bakery stuff helping you? Is anything working? Woman, great is your faith. He didn't say that to any of the disciples. They were standing around going, what's going on? Well, what's going on here is the Holy Ghost is writing a story for us to guarantee you a miracle. He's saying, look, if you'll become a stalker, overcome a little adversity, bang, your miracle falls. You get it the way you want it. Same Greek word, thelo. She went home, and guess what? Her daughter was laying on the bed, mistranslated. She was thrown on the bed. The demon got a visitation. Oh, yeah. See, Jesus was way over yonder, but the Holy Ghost, he's everywhere. So when that happens there, it happens everywhere. So the demons go, ah, and threw her on the bed when they left. That's the way demons do sometimes. They get fussy. Especially when they're getting their face kicked in. She got off the bed, healed, and ran out to see mama. Watch yourself when you're coming at mothers. You don't want them coming after you. Here it is, Luke 13. You've read this 1,000 times. Here we see the truth revealed again. That some sicknesses are demonic, some sicknesses are medical. These are two illustrations of demonic sicknesses, correct? Here he says, this old woman has a spirit of infirmity, right? A spirit of asthenia. She had it for 18 years. 19 years before she met Christ, she was in good health. The spirit got in here. And then over a period of 18 years, it had given her spinal stenosis, scoliosis, kyphosis, whatever it was. Correct? She'd had it for 18 years. She didn't have it 19 years ago. She was sunkupto, bent forward. She's, you ever seen a hunchback in the rest home? Yeah, they're pretty common. She was sunkupto. She could not stand up anymore. Right? He said, woman, you are, once again, the purpose of the Son of God was to destroy the works of the devil. Luo, loose you from your bondage. Here it is again. Apaluo, loosed, completely loosed is what that means. She was completely released from the spirit of infirmity. And Jesus laid his hands on her. Okay? Stood straight up. Then she did what you're supposed to do. Got your praise going. Yeah. You can get your praise going before you need deliverance and then get delivered. And you can get it going after you get delivered and healed. Whatever section you go in is a good one. The demons hate praise. It's like scratching a chalkboard. Years ago, a lot of you don't have any idea what I'm talking about, but I remember the day clearly. I was in fourth grade in Millbury, Ohio. I was in Millbury, Ohio grade school, small town. And I was madly in love with my fourth grade teacher. Her name was Karen Bullis. And she was the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. Every time I looked at her, I froze. She was writing on the board one day, and she dropped the chalk, and she had beautiful hands, long fingernails, and the fingernails went like this. And I remember sitting in the seat, my body froze. I had a paralysis. Well, that exact same experience happens to demons when the Holy Ghost shows up. Sometimes they get stiff like that. Sometimes they are yelling, ah! Doesn't matter what they do. The only thing that matters is they go. And what they do when they hear you going with your praise, oh, man, that's my Karen Bullis scraping the chalkboard. They don't want to hear that. That gets on their nerves. Because they know they're going to get a kick in the head. Yeah. They hear the praise and they get the kick. That's not good, is it? It's beautiful. And here's some patients that had kyphosis. That's what she had. Bent forward, syncopto. Poor kid has it there. This is obviously demons. No kid has arthritis like that. Stupid. Here's scoliosis. See that little S there? That's 100% demonic. Look at that. Rheumatoid arthritis. Nobody has that. That's not a real illness. That's all. There's a child that has rheumatoid arthritis. Come on. That's not a medical condition. That is demonic. Period. No kid has rheumatoid arthritis. Give me a break. And Jesus said that this was the work of Satan, like Job. And he had bound her for 18 years. 19 years previously, she was okay. And Jesus asked him a simple question to the pastor who got mad at him. See, if you break protocol in a church, I mean, they freak out like somebody in the federal government. They go nuts. What? We don't do it that way. Are you kidding me? Well, hold on. No, we take the offering before the... To give the pastor some advice, what they ought to do is do the doxology first and then clear the place out. Those of you who are religious enjoyed that joke. Those of you who are not, good for you. The pastor got on him. Can you imagine that? Yes, you can. Christians frequently get on God. They file complaints with him. They shake their head at him. What are you doing? When are you going to show up? Why'd you do it that way? When are you going to do it? How much long? Pastors, parishioners, everybody is, come on, man. Every born-again Christian has for one moment turned into Joe Biden. Come on, man. With God. They are fussy with him. It's never God doing it. It's always the devil. Always him. And this pastor got on him. Hey, we don't do it that way. Listen, here, you violated our church protocol. We don't do this and do that. And Jesus shamed the guy. What are you talking about? You're a pastor of the church. What's wrong with you? Your job is to pastor. You've got to care about somebody. You're supposed to love people. What are you doing griping about her getting healed? You don't even care she was sick. What's wrong with you? Well, the pastor didn't tell the truth. He should have said, well, I'm loaded with demons, but other than that, I'm fine. No, he didn't say that, but that's really what was happening. He had religious demons. You ever met somebody with religious demons? Oh, they make you want to go get a knife from True Value Hardware and just go bleed it out. You ever seen somebody with religious demons? Absolutely drives you nuts. They talk a mile a minute. They don't even take a breath. They can get a whole page in one breath. And the information is all spiritual. I mean, it's deep. And you ask them a question after they're done, you can't even get it in. If you give them 2 to 3 hours, and I gave one guy in counseling session one time 3 hours. He talked to me for 3 hours. And I just determined, I said, Lord, you sent this guy in here, right? Okay, you knew he was going to do this to me. So, okay, I'm in. I sat at my desk. I keep a handgun underneath here. I reached for it twice, pulled my hand, stop it. 3 hours. I knew everything from Genesis to Revelation. After he was all done, after 3 hours, I said to the guy, why are you still sick? He just sat there staring at me. He just stared at me. I was able to help him. I said, if somebody that knows as much about religion and spiritual things and the Bible as you do, and you know a lot more about it than me, you could tell I was just sitting there saying nothing. Why are you sick? Why'd you come see me? Brother Mike, you've convinced me. Oh, good. You don't want to be a counselor. It is tough being a counselor because you've got to have the patience of Job. How'd that story go? Okay. Now here's Luke chapter 9. What time we got here? 8:20. Okay. Okay. Now here's another example of this section is illnesses related to spirits, right? Not medical conditions. These are demonic illnesses. And this one is a bad one. Luke 9. A man cried out and he said, Didascalus, teacher, I beg you, look on my son. He is my only child. Okay, why is that in there? Because in the Jewish world, your son was the most important child. Your firstborn son was the most important of the children, right? And so this is put in the text, my only child, showing how crucial the situation was and why the guy was so desperate. Okay, so if you had 5 sons, which most people did, and this one died, then this one assumed the top spot. The second eldest, right? And so this is a trauma situation. He has no other sons. No one will take care of his wife after he dies. No one will be there to inherit his property. Nothing. He's got nothing. He says a spirit takes him. Now this guy had been shopping his child around to deliverance ministries, and this goes on all the time. It's really hard. And whenever I have a case like this, that's one of the first questions I ask them. How many people have you taken your son or daughter to before? And they'll always tell you, 5 or 6. The reason they do that is because of love and because they're desperate. They want something done with their child. And it says he suddenly, for no reason, starts screaming. And he has paraso seizures. And he foams at the mouth. Centribo, he gets shattered from falling. He gets all these bruises all over his body. And it never departs. It's chronic condition, is what he said. Okay, so you've got a severely disabled child here. And it says, wherever the demon takes him, he, Regnumai, he breaks him up. He breaks his bones. He foams at the mouth. He trizo, he grinds his teeth. He's wasting away. Sereno. That's where we get our English word anorexia. He's dying of malnutrition. The kid's falling apart. He's broken up. He's beaten up. This is a severe disability. Correct? Okay. I spoke to your disciples that they should cast him out. They couldn't do it. This is a very common issue. As you recall the context of the story, Jesus is on the Mount of Transfiguration. He comes down for the best day of his life, and he brings the three knuckleheads with him. They had been up on the mountain seeing people from heaven. Remember? And Jesus was back in heaven in his glory. The glory he had in heaven came down here and hit him. And that's the only time in his life he was back in his glory. See? So he's on top of the world. He's having the best day he's ever had. He's enormously encouraged, happy, thrilled, feeling good and looking good. Having a great day. In fact, his clothes were instantly dry cleaned. It said his clothes were beaming out the glory. He was right where he's supposed to, where he is now. He's where he was then, where he is right now, in his glory. That's where he belongs. Having the greatest day of his life, he comes down to the nightmare of humanity. He looks over at his disciples, who he left in charge. They let him down. And he hears a bunch of commotion going on over there. Well, this kid's manifesting, and everybody's yelling at demons, and everything's gone bad. And it says the scribes were questioning them. And Jesus said, why were you questioning them? See? What had happened was they had gotten in a deliverance fight. And that happens a lot in Christianity. No, no, no. We do it this way, you do it that way, you're supposed to use that, you need oil, you need a cross, you need a tape, you need this, you need a robe. No, you need to say in Jesus' name. No, you need the Yeshua name. Ah, you need Yahshua. Nah, you need Jehovah. Ah! They were having deliverance fights. Okay? I've heard several of those over the years. They're sickening. Let me give you a side note to the story. There is no such thing as a deliverance method. Okay? Here's what you got to do. Cluck, 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 cluck. That does not exist. That's why there's so little information about these deliverances in the New Testament. There's almost nothing there. Why? Because the Holy Spirit develops your healing and your deliverance ministry based on, you know, your interests, your desires, your personality. You know, not everybody has the same personality. Duh. So you may not feel comfortable with using this method, right? Now, here's how we do it at our church. How do you do that? Well, what we do is, we bring the deliverance, person needs deliverance in. We sit them in the video room and we make them watch these videos on deliverance. And then they start acting like that. Well, listen, I'm not knocking that. That's probably a good idea. Those are interesting videos. But that doesn't mean you have to have a video. Correct? Right. Okay. So, listen. I got this tape off the internet. Take this home and listen to this tape. Okay. How'd that sound? Good. I got some deliverance off that tape. Okay. Good. Tapes are good. But that doesn't mean you have to have a tape. Now here's how you do it. You put the Bible here and you go like that. Oh, you is this one go last or does that go first? No, this goes last, dummy. Okay, thank you. Now you say this. In the name of Yeshua, I go. Okay. Do I say it like that or do I put a little hum to it or a little music? No, just say it like that. Okay. And you go like that. Then you go up. Then you go south. Then you go west. Then you go east. Oh, okay. Okay, thanks. Didn't know that. Take a note of it. Now that worked. See, it worked. That guy got delivered. Did you see that? Okay, that's true. That did work. Go ahead and use it. But that doesn't mean you have to use it. God uses different people with different personalities using some different methods. It's not cookie cuttered in stone that you have to do it the way I do it. When I was at the House of Healing about 15 years ago, I guess I was so excited about deliverance and healing. I was so thrilled with it that I started yelling at demons. And I still do it a little bit today, but back then I did it all the time. Come out, you devil! I'd yell at him. And my wife took a break from shopping on Amazon and said to me one day, why do you have to yell at these people all the time? I said, I don't know. I was just doing it. And it was working. So in my mind, I said, I'll just keep doing it. Well, I started to add people on my ministry team. And they would watch me do it, and it worked. So then they started yelling. So at the House of Healing, the place was really small, you know, like this size here. Like, see this thing here? Just this section? That was the House of Healing, basically. And pretty soon I got 5 or 6 or 7 people on the ministry team, which is great. I love having them on it. I want them to learn and grow. But we were all yelling. And the decibels, the noise in there was giving me transfers. I would have to go home and yell at them in me, get out! Because it was so loud. And then after a few years, I got it. I didn't need to yell. See? I should have been yelling at my wife about the Amazon purchases. But I wasn't. I was yelling at the demon, see? Threw me off. Threw me off. So, just because somebody has a certain method or personality style for deliverance doesn't mean you have to do it or you have to tell others to do it. Even though it works, okay? And there's nothing wrong with it. I'm not criticizing them. I'm just saying that God uses different people in different ways for healing and deliverance. If you look at all the great faith healers, and I've read all of them had little different idiosyncrasies of how they handled people and how they got delivered. There's no pattern to healing, right? And I think that's why Jesus deliberately did different things, right? This guy, he's spitting him. Spit right in his eye. This guy, he spit on the ground. Scooped up some mud. Plastered it on his eyes. Go wash over there. Well, look, we don't have a pool of Siloam here, and I don't have any mud. So that means my anointing's now been stopped, and no one can get healed. Stupid. He did different things because he was showing you there's different things to do, right? In one instance, they went out and they used oil. They anointed with oil and they got healed. I have oil here. We use oil. But I don't use it on every case, and you're not required to. There's no oil requirement. Okay? Many people have been healed without being anointed with oil, and many have been healed being anointed with oil. So all I care about is the healing, not how they got healed. Right? So you may not have a personality for doing it a certain way. That's okay. You go forward. The Holy Ghost heals. It's not, you know, exactly how you do it. It shows you the basics. All healings are through the broken body of Christ and in the name by the authority of the living Christ. Okay? Everybody's got that. And then after that, yeah. If you go to God and say, Lord, I really feel my anointing when I wear a cone head. Boop. Okay. Put a cone head on. Get a big old robe and grab a staff and roam around like Dowie and heal the masses. Good. Good for you. I'll buy you the staff. Good. Just get them healed. Right? The greatest faith healer ever lived up till that time was John Dowie. Right? He wore a cone head. He had a massive robe. Big old staff. Rawr. Fine. Good for him. Go get healed. Put on a cone head. Who cares? Get healed. That's what they were fighting about. Back to the story. So the disciples who fight about Christian things naturally lose their faith. Because once you start arguing about Christianity, your faith goes from here to here. Because arguing brings frustration and exhaustion and doubt. Okay? So fighting over doctrinal procedures causes your faith to tank. So the disciples are going, well, yeah. You didn't get him out, did you? You're supposed to do it this way. Solomon said, pour the water here and then wipe the thing there, you idiot. Whoa, maybe I am an idiot. And they went back and forth, back and forth. That's why Jesus said, what are you questioning him about? What's going on here? What's happening here? And he's thinking, I just left my glory. I got to get out of here. Why? Christianity is a wonderful religion. The problem is it's full of Christians. My God. Bring the boy here. What was he trying to do there? There was a big commotion going on. Everybody was having a big fit. So he was trying to decelerate the situation. Bring the boy over here. Get the boy away from those people. Well, they brought the boy over here, and the crowd followed him. Remember that? They couldn't cast him out. Jesus, and here's why they couldn't. If you start arguing about deliverance methods, your faith is going to go like that, and you're not going to be able to get them delivered. See, it's a faith issue. Confusion causes faith to go down. See? Unity of the brethren causes it to go up. Fighting over doctrine and theology never works. Ruins the anointing. He just come off the mountain of transfiguration. Couldn't have been any better. And you see the response of it. How much longer do I have to put up with these Christians? I showed you how to do it. I told you how to do it. I go back to my glory for a couple of hours, and I come back here, and you screwed everything up. Hey, everybody gets it. Everybody has trouble with people. People are tough. How much longer am I? Well, when the demons saw what was going on, listen, while you're in confusion, fighting over theology, fighting over doctrine, church hopping, taking your child to multiple deliverances, while you're going through all this commotion, the demons are perfectly at rest because they love chaos. And once the demon in the kid saw that the chaos wasn't working anymore, he starts panicking. Wigglesworth walked upstairs into this rich man's house. Remember that story? And he looks at the girl in the corner. She runs over to the corner, naked, screaming. And the demon turns around and looks at Wigglesworth. I know who you are. You're Wigglesworth. They knew him by name. We're not coming out. You can't cast us out. But that girl had seen 50 exorcists all over town, 500 pastors, everything. The demons didn't know anybody. They knew him. Why? The chaos was over. That's why demons scream in the service. Ah! They fall down. They knock over some chairs. They poop their pants. Why? Us. They're putting on a dog and pony show for us, hoping to confuse us, hoping to get us to debate and argue over a spiritual issue so they can stay in there. But if they see it's not working, then they start panicking. Then they come out. They live in chaos. They love your insane family. Everybody in your family is nuts. They love it. They love the fights in the church and the splits and the divisions. Oh, they love it. They're perfectly calm through the whole thing. We're rattled. They got their feet on the sofa. Relaxing. But Jesus wasn't going for the chaos. And the demon then starts manifesting in a last ditch attempt to stay in. Whenever they start manifesting, let your heart be encouraged. You're doing something right. He has a seizure, spirazo. The boy Pipto falls forward to the ground and started Kuleo wallowing around in the dirt, going in a circle like that, having an epileptic, grand mal epileptic seizure. See that? He's putting on a show now. He's trying to get the chaos back. He wants another argument to spring up. He wants the disciples and the scribes to go at it again. That's what he was doing. He was controlling the whole deliverance. That's how smart they are. And Jesus asked the dad, how long has this been going on? Paidiothen means when he was an infant. He was sick as a baby. That's how long this poor guy had been suffering with this. And then he tells him what the demon does to his son since he was a baby. He throws him, balo, he throws him into the fire and the water, trying to get him to kill himself. If you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. The dad had taken the child around to multiple deliverance services and multiple deliverance ministers, and the more you take them, the lower your faith goes. Each succeeding failure causes your faith to drop just another inch. and it just kind of goes on a stock market decline like that. You know? And so now he thinks Jesus may be in the same line as all these other people who have let him down in the past. Whenever you are facing chronic disappointment over the years, it just sucks your faith completely out of you. And you begin to doubt everything about God, about the Bible, about anything. And this guy is talking to God face to face and is still doubting. See that? That can happen to any Christian. And does. Then Jesus says back to him the same thing. If you can believe, all things are possible to stalkers. This guy was a stalker with unbelief attached. He had an unbelief component in his stalking. And guess what? It gets fixed. The father instantly repents. The father of the Paideon, now we know the child was a toddler. See that? This was a young kid, right? 4, 5, 6, something like that. He was little. He cries out with tears and confesses his sin. Oh, man. Remember my fourth grade teacher there? She dropped that chalk and rah, like that. Ugh. When you confess your sins, demons hate that. They want you to cover it up. You're good. You're fine. You're not going to get healed. You got to confess it. There's no other choice. What was his sin? The number one sin of all, right? It's the worst sin of all. Unbelief. Was the guy sincere about his prayer? Or was he a regular Christian? No, it looked to me like the guy was sincere. He was weeping. He said, I do believe, but I have unbelief mixed in my faith. Great teaching. This sermon will preach all day long. When the people came running, once again, the other demons in the crowd said, hey, this thing going very bad for us. We got to rush them. Let's attack. Hey, that's going to happen to you. You turn your life over to God, you start making steps forward, and the devil will start coming in with people you can't even believe. You'll get calls from people you haven't talked to in years. They go, oh my God, this person is, they're moving, they're getting free, they're confessing their sins. We need to call in reinforcements. Where's the relatives? The people come running. That was all demonic. They were attacking them. Why? With what? Confusion. And Jesus instantly saw it and stopped it. See that? Yesterday, Wednesday on Rick's Zoom service, some guy got on there who was heavily infected with demons, and during the deliverance of the guy, he started giggling. I've seen that 100 times before. Whenever that happens, stop. What does that mean? That means the demon knows something you don't. There's something this person has or has done or won't confess, or something. The family, the parent, there's something going on somewhere that you're not aware of. And if you continue on with the deliverance, it's going to go bad. They're not going to get healed. He's laughing because he knows something you don't. They laugh because, hey, you know what? I'm mocking you. You don't have the authority to do this. I know you. Like the sons of Sceva. In this situation, we don't see that, obviously. Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, and he says, he calls this one out by its kind, and these are, I think, at the top of the rotten scale, as far as I'm concerned. In 17 years, these are the toughest ones I've ever faced. Dumb and deaf spirit. Okay, so that means that the kid, Elalos, was deaf. But he could speak a little bit. So it says, I command you, I order you, epitasso, hey, come out and never enter into him again. Notice that the kid was a toddler. You can't do that with adults because they have free will, but you can do it with kids. You can keep the demon from coming back into the kid because they're little. Remember, it was a toddler. This wasn't a teenager or an adult, young adult. And then the disciples ask him later, why couldn't we cast him out? Same answer he gave the dad. The worst sin of all. I don't believe that's going to work. Number one blocker of healings. Number one blocker of deliverances. Number one blocker of your destiny is unbelief. Your health, your finances, your family, all of it. Unbelief. Any questions before we close? I guess we'll stop there. Part two is the next seminar. That one's really interesting. Yeah.
When I was doing real hard, I'm about to give up, give me a job, and live on my disability, and not continue preaching, and I'm done. I'm a true prophet, that's why I do like a liar. And yeah. The people are not blessing. Today I need to leave motel. I just got one day. Somebody is always being grateful to me. I'm tired. I can't handle that no more.
Okay, well, that's a long answer there, so hold off on that one. Yeah, anybody else got a question before we close? Tonight, you're going to release your unbelief. Preach.
Yeah, so you mentioned Job. And I heard that the word consider, when he said, you consider my servant Job, it's really, God was saying, have you set your heart against my servant Job?
Yeah. That's right, because he noticed he's being tracked. See, I've heard that story criticized so many times, you wouldn't believe it. You know? Well, why did God do that? Is he a masochist? Why would he do so? No, the devil already was going to destroy him. He saw the devil was honing in on him. So he said, hey, I'm going to outfox him again, as he always does, and give the deliverance center the book of Job. I win. I won.
Plus, Job's hedge of protection was already down. Because he remember he said the great spheres come upon him. He referred to his kids.
His family. Yep. See, Job would offer sacrifices and everything for his family. They didn't know anything about it. He's trying to cover all of his bases. Why? He was praising with fear. And that never works. Fear wipes out your faith. It wipes out your praise. It wipes out everything. Have you ever seen people worship God in fear? Yeah, kind of a rattle to it. Jesus, hallelujah. Oh, that thing's got to come out of there. Yeah, praising with fear does not work. And the worst thing I feared the most has come upon me. He lost his family. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll just comment on that. Bill said the thing I feared the most has come upon me. That left the door open.
Yeah, because he's being tracked. And the devil caught him. Plus, he hated what Job was doing. He was a godly man. He cared. He loved. He's a good man of God. He loved his family, but that love turned into fear. A lot of mothers have that. That's a different Bible study. They love so much they're now afraid of their kid's future. All right. Okay. Anybody else? Part 2 next month's seminar. Let's go to prayer now.